Cathedral for this service as we celebrate 1,350 years since the foundation of the original monastery here by St. Etheldreda. Do join us if you can after the service for refreshments in the Lady Chapel for coffee and tea and today also sherry. And do join us again at 4 o'clock if you're able for a celebratory festal evensong and procession. We're so very grateful to all who have contributed to make the decorations of the cathedral this weekend and to beautify it in other ways, musically and liturgically. Our thanks to all the staff and volunteers who have enhanced our celebrations in this way. Thank you. Unfortunately, we're not able to offer the ministry of healing during the Eucharist today. But at the end of the service, after communion, there will be a hymn which includes a procession for all of us up to the area of the shrine. So please do follow the choir after the direction of the stewards and join us in the presbytery gathered around or in the choir area so that we can be together for a prayer and a blessing there. It is a sadness for me to announce that Nigel Abbott, Emeritus Canon of St. Albans Abbey, died on Thursday morning at home with Elizabeth. We give thanks for his life and pray for her and him and their daughters and grandchildren. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Before our service, we keep a moment of quiet as we prepare to worship God in spirit and in truth.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May I add my warm welcome to everybody this morning as we continue to celebrate our glorious foundress, St. Etheldreda, and a huge thank you to everybody who has been involved in the celebrations and in the beautifying of the cathedral in so many ways. I'm hugely grateful to everybody for all that's been done. We had a fantastic day yesterday and more to come today. And first of all, I invite you to sit because it's my pleasure to admit two new members to the Cathedral Foundation.
Mr. Dean, I present to you the Reverend Anne Williams to be admitted to the Foundation. Anne has recently made her home in Ely and serves as priest in charge of St. Peter's Church. She has accepted our invitation to become a priest vicar among us.
Mr. Dean, I present to you Mark Hawker to be admitted to the Foundation.
Thank you for your presentation, but first let the oath appointed by law be taken.
I, Anne Mark Williams, promise obedience to the constitution and statutes of the Cathedral Church of Ely, and to Dean as head thereof, as also the chapter, in all things lawful and honest, concerning the said constitution and statutes, and all bylaws and orders thereunder, lawfully made. And I acknowledge the Bishop of Ely as visitor of the said cathedral church, and I submit to the visitatorial jurisdiction conferred upon him, whether by the said constitution and statutes or otherwise by law, insofar as they shall be concerned in or about the affairs of the said cathedral church, and insofar as in me lies, I will endeavour to promote the peace and well-being of the said cathedral church, the Lord being my helper.
Anne, Mark, I admit you to the foundation of this cathedral church. May the Lord prosper you in the work you undertake in his name. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your heart. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always. Amen. I invite you to congratulate the two new members of our foundation. Do you please stand?
Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, looking to Jesus in penitence and faith. Lord, you are gracious and compassionate. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are loving to all, and your mercy is over all your creation. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Your faithful servants bless your name and speak of the glory of your kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal God, who bestowed such grace upon your servant Etheldreda, that she gave herself wholly to the life of prayer and to the service of your true religion, grant that we, like her, may so live our lives on earth seeking your kingdom, that by your guiding we may be joined to the glorious fellowship of your saints. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the first book of Chronicles. King David said to the whole assembly, "My son Solomon, whom alone God has chosen, is young and inexperienced, and the work is great. For the temple will not be for mortals, but for the Lord God. So I have provided for the house of my God, so far as I was able, the gold for the things of gold, the silver for the things of silver, and the bronze for the things of bronze, the iron for the things of iron, and wood for the things of wood, beside great quantities of onyx and stones for setting, antimony, colored stones, all sorts of precious stones and marble in abundance. Moreover, in addition to all that I have provided for the holy house, I have a treasure of my own of gold and silver. And because of my devotion to the house of my God, I give it to the house of my God. 3,000 talents of gold, of the gold of Ophir, and 7,000 talents of refined silver for overlaying the walls of the house, and for all the work to be done by artisans, gold for the things of gold, and silver for the things of silver. Who then will offer willingly, consecrating themselves today to the Lord? For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lord is as my lifeline. Reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I've already obtained this, or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I've made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal, for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us then who are mature be of the same mind. And if you think differently about anything, this too God will reveal to you. Only let us hold fast to what we have attained. Brothers and sisters, join in imitating me and observe those who live according to the example you have in us. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
With you.
And also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Truly I tell you, it will be hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astounded and then said, "Then who can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but for God all things are possible." Then Peter said in reply, "Look, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have?" Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man is seated on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or children, or fields for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. It's wonderful to be celebrating 1,350 years since Etheldreda founded the double monastery here, giving thanks for 1,350 years of Christian witness and worship in this place. And again, a huge thank you to those who've contributed to our festivities this week in particular and throughout the year. It's not over yet. The story of this extraordinary East Anglian princess continues to captivate our imaginations. She who in the early 7th century desired from an early age to be a nun, but before realizing her vocation was married twice, though neither marriage was consummated. And after several adventures, as recorded in the Liber Eliensis and Bede's history, founded the joint monastery here in 673 and died on the 23rd of June 679. Pilgrims began flocking to her simple burial place, and so for a few years after that, her body was exhumed for reinterment and found to be incorrupt. And there was then placed a glorious shrine on the spot marked in the current presbytery. Its demise we owe to the glittering scythe of Bishop Thomas Goodrich in the 16th century. But the light of her vision and faith was not quenched, and prayers of our patron saint continue to support us. What so attractive was her devotion to the Lord Jesus Christ? As our New Testament reading put it, "I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing knowledge of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord." Despite being of noble birth and considerable wealth, Etheldreda sought only her Lord, and in death asked for only the simplest of burials. That relationship to, or rather detachment from, riches, wealth, and status accounts for the passage chosen for our gospel this morning. And I just want to say a few things about that challenging passage, lest we get totally taken up on how wonderful Etheldreda is. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. I'm going to ask you a question. How many of you think you are rich? There's a half a wave of a hand over there, a one down there. Well done, thank you. I'm shocked. There's a big lesson for us to learn. I went to a lecture not long ago given by a member of this congregation in Cambridge. You can see I'm departing from my text because I suddenly thought I would. I went to a lecture at a college in Cambridge given by somebody, a member of our congregation, who is an engineer. And he's doing a lot of work on net zero. And the statistics he put up are quite sort of eye-opening. That whether we like it or not, we in this country are in the top 2 or 3% of the richest people in the world. Hands up if you think you're rich. We're all rich. Every one of us here, in compared with other people in the world, are rich. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. This gospel is about us and not about other people. There's a lovely story of the Methodist minister, Donald Soper, preaching, and that he said how difficult it was to preach. We found it difficult to preach hard sermons to his congregation because he didn't like looking on them and seeing the look on their faces. So he finally solved the problem that when he preached, he wore his glasses. So when he looked at the congregation, he couldn't see how they were reacting. Very often this message about wealth gets watered down because we want it to be palatable. I remember having a little book which I read to my children about this parable, and it exemplified the watering down beautifully. It said that there was a gate in Jerusalem called the Eye of a Needle. It was very small, but if a camel had all its load removed and then it could just squeeze through, the implication was that the wealthy don't need to worry too much. Perhaps if they kneel down and shed a little and try really hard, they can get into the kingdom. The fact of the matter is that there's not a shred of evidence for a gate in Jerusalem called the Eye of a Needle. Rather, it was the invention of a medieval monk who wished to placate his wealthy master and make him feel better. And it's been loved by preachers ever since, who don't want their rich congregations to go home feeling uncomfortable before their lavish Sunday lunch. This parable is told by Jesus in the response to a young man coming to him and saying, "What good deed must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus possibly sounds a little tetchy with the man who comes up to him, but there's a seriousness to his question. He's kept all the laws, he's done all the things he thinks he ought to do, but something's missing. Most Jews would never have asked the question because they'd have taken it for granted that keeping the law was enough to get you into the kingdom. Jesus warms to the young man and tells him that there is more to a relationship with God than negative blamelessness with respect to the law. The way to eternal life is to throw in one's lot with Jesus and follow him in the path of discipleship. So Jesus also says, if you wish to be perfect, go sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor and you will have treasure in heaven. And then come follow me. There's consternation among the disciples. And then Jesus says, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than from someone rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. It's easier for a camel than for any one of us to enter the kingdom of heaven. Consternation, not least, because actually quite a lot in the Old Testament that equates wealth and possessions with blessings from God. And then we come to the crux of the matter. For mortals, it is impossible. But for God, all things are possible. And here we have what it seems to me is the most difficult lesson of all to learn about the Christian faith. And that is that the Christian faith and living has absolutely nothing to do, first of all, with keeping laws and regulations. Inasmuch as there is absolutely nothing we do to earn God's love, He loves us, whatever. It seems that for all, rich or poor alike, the true relationship with God involves virtually impossible conditions. No wonder the disciples stumble around saying, "Who can be saved?" The heart of Jesus' reply is crucial. If men and women are to be saved, it's solely to do with the grace and unlimited love of God. We can do nothing to save ourselves. It's all the work of God. We're simply invited to accept that love and respond to it. We do other things because God loves us. We don't do good things in order to earn God's love. We can't do it. Don't fret that you have to earn God's love. It's all amazing grace, truly amazing. And it was that dedication in response to Jesus' love of her that led Etheldreda to serve her Lord, to found the monastery that was here, and which was revived again in the 11th century. May it be that same dedication to knowing and sharing the love of God shown in Jesus Christ that empowers us. It is that same love shown by Jesus on the cross and in his resurrection that is shared freely and abundantly beneath the forms of bread and wine at this altar, given to us, given totally out of love. We do nothing to earn it, we just hold out our hands. And by the grace of God, may we go joyfully from here, knowing that we are rich, rich in so many ways, and to share that richness and that love with a very needy world, and to do so to the glory of the one and only living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We proclaim the Church's faith in Jesus Christ. We believe and declare that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is both divine and human. God of the being of the Father, the only Son from time began, human from the being of his mother, born in the world. Fully God and fully human, human in both mind and body. As God, he is equal to the Father. As human, he is less than the Father. Although he is both divine and human, he is not two beings, but one Christ. One not by turning God into flesh, but by turning humanity into God. Truly one, not by mixing humanity with Godhead, but by being one person. For as mind and body form one human being, so the one Christ is both divine and human. The Word became flesh and lived among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Let us pray to the Lord, who gives life to the Church and to the world. Let us pray for the Church. Today we remember and give thanks for Etheldreda, Queen, Abbess, and Saint. We thank you that she chose to renounce earthly glory, to follow a life of faith in Christ, founding the double monastery here 1,350 years ago. We thank you that her heritage lives on in this holy place, and we pray for all churches and chapels named in her honor, especially the people and clergy of the Roman Catholic Church of St. Etheldreda here in Ely. Let us pray for all who continue the work of Etheldreda and the saints and evangelists of the past in our own times, and for those to be ordained in this cathedral next weekend. Lord, bless all those given authority in your church, that they may minister your grace to those who seek after you and serve you faithfully in serving others. Lord, hear us. Let us pray for our world. We pray for all nations, and especially for places where there is persecution, where there is violence and war, where there is alienation and anxiety. Let us pray for a renewed commitment on the part of all our leaders to building the confidence, trust, and security that allows people to flourish. King of Peace, you long for us to live in fellowship and unity. Send your Spirit of Peace throughout the world and draw us together into one family of nations. Lord, hear us. Let us pray for our communities, for those homes where families are struggling to get by, for places where there are ongoing arguments and feuds, places where children are unloved, neglected, or in danger. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of relationship, for the blessing of family and friends. We pray that we would have the wisdom and steadfastness to nurture all our relationships in good times and bad. Help us to find your presence in all situations and make us more generous in sharing your love. Lord, hear us. Let us pray for those whose bodies, minds, or spirits are racked with pain, doubt, exhaustion, or sorrow. And we pray for those who care for them. Today, our prayers are specially asked for Kai, Yvonne, Sister Mary, Cleo, Jim, and we lift to you those who have no one to pray for them. Heavenly Father, healer of the sick and strength of the weak, look with mercy on all who are suffering at this time. Bring healing and peace, and give strength to those who care for the suffering. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Let us pray for those who have died and have passed from this life to eternity, remembering especially in our prayers today Nigel Abbott Priest, Gail Dennison, and at their year's mind this week, Dorothy Hughes, Harold Miller, Mabel Miller, and John Bonney. God of all comfort, may those who have died rest in the eternal peace of your presence. Bring to those in the darkness of grief this day your light and warmth. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We join all our prayers with those of Our Lady, St. Etheldreda, and all the saints, as we commend ourselves and all for whom we have prayed to God's mercy and protection. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who were far off and those who were near. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Accept the gifts we bring to your table on this feast of St. Etheldreda. Free us from the things that keep us from you and teach us to seek you as our only good. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and
praise. It is truly right and good, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. This day we honour you in St. Etheldreda, who consecrated her life to Christ for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. In her you show us your saving love as you call the human race back to its first holiness and invite us to taste on earth the gifts of the world to come. In communion with angels and archangels and all who served you on earth and worship you now in heaven, we raise our voice to proclaim your glory, forever praising you and singing.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Our Lady, St. Etheldreda, St. Dunstan, St. Etheldwold, St. Benedict, St. Catherine, St. Edmund, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. After the post-communion prayer, during the hymn, we will process together up to St. Etheldreda's shrine. Do, if you are able, join in that procession as quickly and expeditiously as you can and gather as close to the shrine as you can. Let us pray. Merciful God, who gave such grace to your servant Etheldreda, that she served you with singleness of heart and loved you above all things, help us, whose communion with you has been renewed in this sacrament, to forsake all that holds us back from following Christ and to grow into his likeness from glory to glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Light
enlighten, we beseech you, O merciful Lord, the hearts of your faithful people, and by the example of your servant Etheldreda, teach us to seek the things which are above. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Give you grace to follow Our Lady, St. Etheldreda, and all his saints in faith and hope and love, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.